Hello, my name is Professor Edzard Ernst. I'm giving a lecture on research into so-called alternative medicine. Here we have the outline of my lecture. I'm going to briefly give you some background. Talk about aims of research, research questions, problems, findings of scam research. Then I'm going to ask how reliable the findings are and eventually come to some conclusions. First, background. This is about myself. I've studied medicine. And my first job was in a homeopathic hospital where I learned all sorts of alternative treatments. Later, I became a conventional doctor, spent time in basic research, became a professor first in Germany, then Austria, then in England, Exeter, where I built up a team to research alternative medicine. We published a lot together, and since 2012, I'm emeritus professor, giving lectures, writing books, and a blog, which you are invited to visit. Why do I call it scam and not alternative medicine? Three reasons, really. If any sort of therapy does not work, it cannot possibly be a scam. If, however, treatment does work, it has to be medicine. So alternative medicine doesn't make sense. And the third reason is that I also published a book with the title Scam. My definition of scam is, it's an umbrella term for a diverse range of therapeutic modalities, also diagnostic modalities, and they have very little in common other than being outside mainstream medicine. And we have a range of 400 different modalities going from acupuncture to zone therapy. The aims of research, broadly speaking, can be named as to observe, to describe, to predict, to determine, and to explain. In terms of scam, this means observing, for instance, that 25% of the UK population use some form of scam, and these 25% relates to the general population. Patient populations can be much higher. To describe, homeopathic consultation can take as long as 1 hour. To predict, cancer patient using scam will die early. To determine cause and effect, chiropractic can cause a stroke. And to explain how this happens, vertebral arteries can break up when a chiropractor manipulates the upper spine. Research questions. These have been my focus in the last 25 years or so. We wanted to find out what works and for what conditions. We wanted to find out what the risks are. We wanted to find out whether the benefits of any treatment outweigh the risks of that therapy. And more recently, I was interested in finding out how reliable the published research into scam really is. Problems of scam research. There we are spoiled for choice. There are many problems. I'm just listing here four different ones in the area of methodology, funding, expertise, and the actual researcher who's doing the work. Methodology is often more complicated than in other healthcare research. For instance, just to mention one problem, what is a good placebo for running placebo-controlled trials in acupuncture? A big debate around this. We have developed a placebo needle. Perhaps that solves the problem. Not everybody is happy with it, however. Funding. There's no funding from the pharmaceutical industry. So who would fund a study of the risk of chiropractic, for instance? Not the chiropractors, and probably not government funding agencies either. Expertise. There's a lack of expertise in SCAM research. Practitioners who do the research often have little understanding of science, and the researcher himself or herself can be perhaps the biggest problem. SCAM researchers are enthusiasts of SCAM, and this enthusiasm gets in the way of objectivity quite often. The findings of SCAM research, very briefly, under some SCAMs are entirely unresearched. Important issues are under-researched. Some SCAMs are effective. Some SCAMs cause harm. And many SCAMs have been tested but failed to convince. I'm going to explain these 5 points with examples. Here we have four different SCAM treatments which are entirely unresearched. If you look for clinical trials of these colonic irrigation lateral shiatsu Schüssler salts, you won't find any. There aren't any. And that means that these unresearched SCAMs are having a free ride. The public believes by and large that these treatments have been tested and are effective, but they haven't even been tested. Secondly, some issues in SCAM research are under-researched. We know very little, for instance, about the direct risks of SCAM. We know little about the interactions of SCAMs with conventional medicine. The indirect risks of SCAM, I think, are very, very important and are under-researched. And the ethical behavior or lack of ethical behavior of SCAM practitioners is also an area which needs more research. The fact that these areas are under research clearly puts patients at risk. Couple of examples. Here we have a list of direct adverse effects of some famous popular forms of alternative medicine: spinal manipulation, acupuncture, homeopathy, and herbal medicine. When we published that 24 years ago, it was so sensational that we could even publish it in Nature. Everybody thought that alternative medicine is harmless. According to our findings then, we found that 16% of patients using spinal manipulation will have adverse effects. In red, you see the actual figures as we know them now. Every second patient will have adverse effects. With acupuncture, we were fairly accurate. Around 12 to 13% will have adverse effects from acupuncture. Homeopathy, people think homeopathy doesn't contain anything. And therefore, it cannot possibly cause adverse effects, but homeopaths expect aggravations of the presenting symptoms in about 20% of patients, and these have to be viewed as adverse effects. And with herbal medicine, it really depends. Some herbal medicine are very safe, others aren't safe at all. But more important, I believe, are the indirect adverse effects. And here we have a study from America a couple of years ago. Oncologists showed that cancer patients using SCAM treatments, in addition to normal cancer treatments, shorten their 5 years survival, their chances of 5 years survival by 50%. This is enormous and very, very important, I think. Thirdly, we have to say, luckily, some SCAMs are effective. Such therapies and only such therapies should be considered for the integration into conventional medicine. A few examples. This is from a book I published a year ago, assessing 150 different modalities and showing that quite a few herbal remedies are definitely effective. Equally, a lot of dietary supplements are effective, and a few are as well, usually through relaxing the patient, and relaxing the patient can affect conditions like asthma or hypertension, for instance. And we have the example of St. John's Wort, probably the best researched herbal remedy of them all. A meta-analysis of 30 randomized clinical trials showing that St. John's Wort is clearly and significantly better than placebo for mild to moderate depression, and equally effective as synthetic antidepressants, as they also have less side effects if you use them properly. They are probably also better than synthetic antidepressants. Fourth point, some SCAMs cause significant harm. And here I'd like to mention spinal manipulation, coffee enemas, chelation therapy, and some herbal remedies. I've already told you that 50% of all patients seeing a chiropractor will have moderate side effects, pain, referred pain, lasting for about 1 or 2 days. And that is not disputed by chiropractors. In addition, we have several hundred cases of severe complications, including deaths. And that is hotly disputed by chiropractors who don't believe that they cause these adverse effects. What does happen? Here we have a drawing of the skull, first vertebra, second and third vertebra. And what you see is the vertebral artery making this kink over the first vertebra, the atlas. And with certain movements that chiropractors can do, this artery gets overextended, breaks up, and then you have a stroke. Fifth point, many SCAMs have been tested quite extensively, but have failed. And here I'd like to mention homeopathy, chiropractic, osteopathy, reflexology. Osteopathy and chiropractic, we have mentioned a little bit, so let's focus on homeopathy. We have today of homeopathy and many, many systematic reviews. Therefore, I've one day published a systematic review of systematic reviews of homeopathy, sort of accumulating all the data from all 50 or so systematic reviews. And what it showed is that the best evidence does not warrant positive recommendations for its use in clinical practice. In other words, there is no good evidence that homeopathic remedies are better than placebo for any condition. Now I'd like to address the question, how reliable is the public research in SCAM? And I'd like to mention just four points here. Much of SCAM research is of very poor. I've mentioned that it is carried out by enthusiasts, and enthusiasts often, sadly, do not do the best research. And this leads to the conclusion that the findings of such research cannot always be trusted. Study designs are popular that cannot ever produce negative results. And that is worrying, because if you already know the result of a clinical trial before you even have started it, then you might as well not do it. It's unreliable, it's poor science. I would say it's pseudoscience. Many clinical trials of SCAM fail to mention adverse effects. That is a clear breach of research ethics, but it also means that anybody looking at these clinical trials to evaluate how often adverse effects occur will create a false positive picture. In other words, a misleading picture that makes us believe that these treatments are safe, whereas in fact, they are not necessarily so. Many SCAM researchers only publish positive results, and that is extremely worrying in my view. That relates to the reliability of the researchers, and particularly interesting in that sense are researchers, Chinese researchers of traditional Chinese medicine. Several people have done research on that and have found that as good as never do these researchers publish negative results. We have shown that the first time in 1999, where we published a review article of almost 3,000 randomized clinical trials, Chinese trials, in the BMJ, and we've shown that practically none of these trials are negative. So everything works for anything. And here in the little graph, you see the subset of acupuncture trials. You see that they all lean towards the right, meaning they're all positive, except three. And that is, in my view, quite suspicious, because it indicates that acupuncture works for everything, which, according to the best findings today, doesn't. I'm coming to my conclusions, just three short conclusions. SCAM research has many problems. I've tried to show you that the research is unreliable because of unreliable, poor quality research, and possibly also of due to unreliable researchers. Many findings are less than reliable, just said that. And the unreliability leads to ill-informed therapeutic decisions. And therefore, SCAM can put consumers and patients at risk. What shall we do about it? I'm not sure I have all the answers for that, but I suggest we raise awareness of the existing problems. Lots of people are not aware of how unreliable the research and its findings are. We stop funding overtly unreliable science in this area, and we train and supervise SCAM researchers properly so that perhaps they do better science than they have done previously. Many thanks. I hope you have interesting questions. Thank you.